Good morning. Are we on? We want to thank Brian for the beautiful music this morning. Thank you, Brian. We appreciate your music. Welcome to our Bethany Church worship service. Welcome to those joining us by Zoom and Facebook. Nehemiah 9, verses 5 and 6 reads, "Praise the Lord, your God, who is from everlasting to everlasting. Blessed be your glorious name, and may it be exalted above all blessing and praise. You alone are the Lord. You made the heavens, even the highest heavens, and all their starry host, the earth and all that is on it, the seas and all that is in them. You gave life to everything, and the multitudes of heaven worship you. You alone, Lord, are worthy of our worship and praise this morning." This week's missions prayer is for Jews for Jesus. Thank you. This missions prayer is for Jews for Jesus, founded in 1973 by Moshe Rosen, a Jewish Christian. They are dedicated to witnessing to the Jewish people that Jesus Christ is the true Messiah. I was shocked by this statistic. Currently, less than one half of 1% of Israelis know Jesus as their Messiah, and fewer than 1 in 10 even know his true name in Hebrew, Yeshua. He is one of their own, the greatest Jew, the greatest person who ever lived. And yet most Israelis don't even know his name or that he ministered throughout the land of Israel. We have some announcements this morning. Due to health concerns, please be aware that some may be uncomfortable with hugs and handshakes. Hearing aids are available for the hearing impaired or for translation to Japanese. Baptism of Fusa Otsubo will start at 1:30 p.m. at the Tanimoto's home. And in the hallway, we have maps for anyone that needs to know where their address is. On Sunday, November 3rd, Bethany Church will celebrate its 111th anniversary. We will have a Father's Day celebration and lunch on Sunday, June 23rd. That's two Sundays from now. Please invite family and friends and sign up to make sure that we have plenty of good food. Oh, I'm sorry, the 16th? Okay. We changed it to the 16th. Okay, thank you. Are there any other announcements? Are there any praise reports or prayer requests this morning? Paul?
Good morning. It's good to be back at church. I had a very interesting spring. First, I had a scheduled 3-hour eye surgery, and still in the process of healing, I still have stitches in my eye that'll come out in about 6 weeks, but the doctor says everything's looking good. 3 days after my eye surgery, I had a disastrous fall at Chio's house, fell down the driveway. She has a steep driveway, and once I started walking down, I couldn't stop, so I crash landed. By the grace of God, I didn't land on my head, but I had the quick reflexes to get my arms out in front of me, and I braced for the fall a little bit. I knew I had broken arms by looking at my arms, so I called for help, and Bob and Agnes came right away, and they determined I needed an ambulance, so We got an ambulance to take me to the hospital. At the ER, they x-rayed my arms and hands, and they gave me a brain CAT scan since I skimmed the side of my head. Many of you would be surprised to learn that the brain CAT scan revealed that I do have a brain. But whether I use it is another question. But I did, after that, I had another 3-hour surgery where they put pins and needles into my arms to hold the bones together. Then, once I was discharged, I struggled for the first 2 weeks with no arms and hands, but I managed with support of friends. It was a disastrous fall, but bad things in life happen, and good things happen too. When good things happen, you have to cherish those moments. When bad things happen, you deal with it and move on, and that's what I'm trying to do. Life offers you many challenges, and with the support of God and friends, I think I've met most of the challenges. I want to say thank you to everyone who prayed for me, who brought meals to me, who drove me to the doctor's office and went to the grocery store for me. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. I appreciate your prayers. I want to say a big thank you to Agnes and Bob and Ken. You were my guardian angels and helped me so much. I appreciate it. But I'm doing good, so it's onward and upward. Thank you so much.
It's good to have you back with us, Paul. Any other announcements? Or okay, let's look to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father in heaven, we're grateful to you for each precious day of life. We love you because you first loved us, even before you gave us the gift of life, and have been with us 24/7, each and every day of our lives. We pray for your anointing and blessing on our worship service and on Pastor Derek as he encourages our love for you and our faith and trust in you because of the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross for our sins and our eternal salvation and a more meaningful and fulfilling life as you would have us live. We pray for Jews for Jesus that they would successfully share the good news of Jesus Christ with all those you put in front of them to minister to. We thank you that you are Jehovah Rapha, the God that heals us. We pray for your healing power and strength on Bobby Kono, Alyssa Carr Mahone, Russ Carr, Haru Sugino, Lloyd Henning, John Slagle, Kanan, Diana Slagle, Linda's niece Andrea and friend Alex, Sugumi's husband Rick, and friends Mike, Rick, Tammy, Brenda, and Donna, Maurice Chin and Alex, Veronica's friend Melissa, Pastor Mariko's father, Daryl Sato, Lily Reese, Monique Wallace, Amina Nadir, Paul Mito, Hiroko Tanimoto, Annie Yamada, and comfort for Chio Oshiro and family following the passing of her husband John, and on the family members of Barbara Fukuzawa, who passed away recently. Please bless the tithes and offerings given to you this week, and that they will be wisely and carefully used by our stewardship committee and board of elders as your Holy Spirit guides and directs them. We pray for an end to the violence in Ukraine, Israel, Syria, Afghanistan, Haiti, Sudan, and other countries experiencing strife. We pray that your Holy Spirit will bring revival to Santa Barbara to our nation and worldwide. We pray this prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please take a minute to greet those that are close to you as the praise team comes forward.
Good morning. Please stand as you are able and let us worship the Lord together in song. Psalm 103 verse 1 says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name." Let's sing together.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship your holy name.
On that day,
and on that day, when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. I worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name.
Amen. Isaiah 6, verse 8 says this, "And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, Here I am, send me. And today we'll be talking about evangelism and how the Lord calls us into his service. So here I am, Lord. Says this, "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord and bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. And we have a story to tell to the nations.
Shall turn their hearts to the right. A story to truth and verse, the story of peace and light, the story of peace and light. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright, and Christ shall lift their hearts to the Lord. A song and a conquer evil, and shatter the spirit's war, and shatter the spirit's war. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright, and Christ kingdom shall come on earth, the kingdom of love and light. In a message to give to the nations, that the Lord who reigns from above has sent his Son to save us and show us that God is love, and show us that God is love. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright, and Christ's great kingdom shall come on earth, the kingdom of love and light. Leave a Savior to show to the nations, through the path of sorrow have fell, that all of the world's great peoples might come to the truth of God, might come to the truth of God. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright, come on earth, the kingdom of love and light. And Christ's great kingdom shall come on earth, the kingdom of love and light.
Yes, Lord, help us to be your hands and feet, and to go out and tell the story, tell your story to the nations, Lord, that we would be a people who say, here I am, Lord, send me, and go wherever you lead us, Lord. We praise your name on high this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
This morning's scripture reading is found in Luke 10, verses 1 through 12. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him, two by two, into every town and place where he himself was about to go. And he said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, I am sending you out as lambs in the midst of wolves. Carry no money bag, no knapsack, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, peace be to this house. And if a son of peace is there, your peace will rest upon him. But if not, it will return to you. And remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves his wages. Do not go from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and they receive you, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick in it and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near you. But whenever you enter a town and they do not receive you, go into its streets and say, even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off against you. Nevertheless, know this, that the kingdom of God has come near. I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day for Sodom than for that town. Lord, please bless the reading of your word this morning.
Good morning once again, and last week we looked at the end of Luke chapter 9 and what Jesus taught us about discipleship, about what it looks like to be a disciple of Christ. And being a disciple of Jesus requires sacrifice, requires that we make him our first priority, and that we fix our eyes on him. Those are some of the things that we took away from last week. Now this week we continue on to chapter 10, and we will be looking at when Jesus appointed the 72 to go out and to preach the gospel. We see how the Lord calls people to go out and to minister in his name. So as we begin our time together, please join me in a word of prayer. Oh Lord, we thank you and praise you for this day, and we thank you for your word, Lord, and how it continues to speak to us and minister to us. And Father, as we come to your word today, help us to just put aside all of whatever's going on in the world around us, in our own lives, Lord, and just help us to focus holy on you, and we ask that your Holy Spirit would come and teach us and illuminate your word to us this morning, Lord, and that we would be able to take it and go out and live it in our everyday lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I was thinking about this message and this text this morning. A few weeks ago, I was watching this program on NHK. It's a Japanese television station, and they have this program called Sarameshi. It talks about like different people who people of different professions, and then they go out and they show their lunch, what they're eating for lunch. So it's kind of an interesting program. But a couple of weeks ago, there was a particular episode about this group of ladies who have a field of nanohana, which is kind of a type of Japanese green, or Japanese green. And what they do is they take these tender yellow flowers. It's very tedious, you know, as the flowers bloom, and they go out and they pick these little flowers, and then from that they make tsukemono. It's a type of Japanese pickled vegetable. It's a very traditional process. And these ladies have been doing this. They've kept this field for over 40 years. And now the ladies are up in their 80s. All of them were like 83, 84, so on and so forth. And they're still very healthy and very active, but, you know, even so, their age has really caught up to them. And so after all this time, it was kind of a sad episode because they finally decided to close down their operation. They've tried to go out and solicit other people to maybe come take it over and learn, you know, this traditional method, but nobody was interested. There's just not a lot of younger people out in the area where they live, so they've closed down their operation. And so, you know, all over Japan, there's a lot of farmland out there, but you see that a lot of these farms have gone fallow because there are no longer enough young people to work in the fields. And it was really, I thought, a really interesting documentary to see how they've continued all this, but very sad to see them tearfully bid farewell to this work that they've been doing for so many years with no one to take over for them. And you might ask, well, what am I telling you this story for? Well, in the passage that was read, Jesus said, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." And I think this applies to Japan in the literal sense, as we see a lot of these farms having to close down because of lack of workers. But even more importantly, this really applies to Japan in a spiritual sense, in the sense that you probably know that fewer than 1% of Japanese people profess the Christian faith. And according to statistics compiled by Japan Mission, the group who we support, the Verways in Japan, the Japanese are the second largest unreached people group in the world. With a population of over 123 million, there's only one missionary per 64,000 people. Think about that. And there's many towns and villages where there is not even a church or any Christian presence at all. So indeed, there is great opportunity for harvest in a country like Japan, but there are very few Christian workers. And same with, as Steve shared with us this morning about the Jews for Jesus, how few within the Jewish community know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And so there are a lot of places out in the world that have not yet been reached for Christ. Now, going back to Luke 9, at the very beginning of Luke 9, Jesus sends out the 12 apostles to preach the kingdom of God, to heal in his name. That was the mission that he sent them out to. And then we come to the beginning of Luke 10, and Jesus appoints this larger group, kind of expanding his ministry, sending 72 people out to minister in his name. And you might call these people the first missionaries, as it were, sent by the Lord to prepare the way for his eventual ministry, because he says that he sent them into the towns where he was going to go himself. And through this passage, God gives us a model of what Christian ministry really should look like, even as he continues to call men and women into the ministry today. Now, one of the things that we learn is that there is strength in shared ministry. We notice in verse 1 that Jesus sends out these people two by two. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him two by two into every town and place where he himself was about to go. Now, Deuteronomy, if you go back into Deuteronomy and when it comes to the law, it talks about the requirement of establishing two or three witnesses. So it's important to have that kind of not just one person witnessing, but two or three witnesses. And then as we go to Proverbs 24, 5 and 6, we read this: "A wise man is full of strength, and a man of knowledge enhances his might. For by wise guidance you can wage your war, and an abundance of counselors there is victory." So it's not, we don't just go out and minister on our own, just one person by himself. You know, when I served in Ishinomaki for 3 months several years ago, it wasn't just physically draining. You know, on a day-to-day basis, we were going out and doing volunteer work and physical labor. But more than physically draining, it was really spiritually draining. And it was so important for us to have that team of other Christians, other believers that to support one another as we were going out every day for ministry activities. We prayed together, we did devotion time together, and so we really can't do ministry on our own. It's not something done in a vacuum. We need, of course, first and foremost, the help of the Lord, and then the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and then we also need that support of other believers around us. I'm reminded of that verse in Ecclesiastes 4, 9 and 10 that says, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their toil. For if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and has not another to lift him up. So it's that importance of shared ministry. And it's same here at our church, right? We have the board of elders. We have multiple pastors that we all kind of try and work together in ministry. Now next we see that there is a need for Christian workers and the importance of prayer. Let's look at what Jesus says in verse 2. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. And this echoes exactly what Jesus said in a different context back in Matthew 9, 37 and 38. So it's clear we see a repetition of Jesus saying this phrase that it's an important message that Jesus really wanted to convey to his followers. And this message remains ever true for us today. It was true in that time and it's true for us today that it's estimated that there are over 3 billion people around the world who are unreached. And when it's say unreached, it means they've never come under the hearing of the gospel. You know, there are a lot of people in the United States, maybe they are not believers, but they've been to a church at some point in their lives. They've heard the gospel. They have access to the Bible. But when we talk about these 3 billion people, these are people who, you know, may not have access to the Bible or may not have ready access to a church. And so we think about that. That's really a staggering statistic that the harvest still is plentiful. There is a harvest out there. And so there's really an urgency for us as believers, as followers of Jesus Christ. There's a real urgency for us to get out and share that good news of the gospel to those who have not yet heard. And that's one of the reasons, I think, why we continue here at Bethany. We may be a small church by any standard, but we continue to really place an emphasis on world missions here at Bethany. And I think we've been blessed to continue to be able to support missionaries all around the world, both financially and through prayer. I think that's really, you know, every Sunday we pray for one of our missionaries here from the pulpit, and we have opportunities to give and to support. And even when we've had real lean times here at this church, you know, Steve Takaya, as our moderator at that time, says, you know, that's our tithe as the church, that we give back, and we have to continue to give in faith. And there was a time when on the stewardship team we said, well, we're going to have to just cut our missionary support. And Steve encouraged us to step out in faith, and we've been blessed to be able to continue to support our missionaries in that way. But more importantly, beyond just the financial support, we need to continue to pray that the Lord would raise up a new generation of laborers who will go out into the harvest. Because a lot of our missionaries are up in age, are getting close to retirement. Some have retired in recent years. And even so, there's still that field out there ready for harvest. And so we have to pray that the Lord would raise up this new group of people to go out into the harvest. Now, those who are called, who are sent by the Lord, are called to reflect his love and compassion toward others. Verse 3 says this, "Go your way, behold, I'm sending you out as lambs in the midst of wolves." Jesus likens the world to wolves. He's warning these disciples that when they go out and they minister, you know what? They're going to face rejection. They're going to face persecution. Some of the cults and world religions, they try to use real aggressive measures to coerce people to become adherents. But that's not the way of the Lord. We're told in Colossians 3, verse 12, that as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. And so when we go out in Jesus' name, those are the qualities that we're called to have. We're called to be as lambs. We're called to show God's love and God's compassion. But we're also to be aware that we will face persecution and we will face rejection. When I was in college, I joined one of my friends whose church was doing street evangelism, going out onto the college campus and, you know, sharing about Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, there were many more people who made snide remarks or completely ignored us than people who were willing to give a few minutes to hear what we had to say, what we had to share. And so we're called to be lambs in the midst of wolves. When we minister in Christ's name, we're called to reflect Christ's love to those who we share, with whom we share. And our actions and the way we present ourselves really are a testament to the Lord. We were just talking about that some of this in our men's Bible study on Tuesday. Back when I was in college, there were these cults out there, and we'd go to the football games, and there'd be these cults, Christian cults, with these big signs say, you know, repent or you're going to go to hell, or all homosexuals are going to hell. And that really, those kind of things were a real turnoff, I think, to anybody who might even remotely be interested in the Christian faith. These people coming very aggressively and very with a lot of hate, it just doesn't seem like that would be win people over to the Lord. And so when we go out and minister in the name of the Lord, we're supposed to show his love and his compassion toward other people. And that really will be a testimony to who God is. And then maybe we have an opportunity to share the truth of the gospel with others. Now, in sending out these disciples, Jesus tells them that they have to trust in the Lord's provision for them. They're to go without taking too many worldly possessions. In verse 4, we read, "Carry no money bag, no knapsack, no sandals, and greet no one on the road." First of all, he did not want these disciples to be distracted by any of these worldly things. It would just weigh them down or distract them from their task at hand. Now it says, don't greet anyone on the road, and you think, wow, that's kind of strange. But again, you go back to that time and that culture, and greetings at that time were kind of these whole formal acts. There was a lot of etiquette required. There was a lot of time required and standing on ceremony. So if you were to go out and individually greet each person, you may spend hours and hours and hours. So I think the point that Jesus is trying to make here is that, again, there's an urgency to their ministry and that they should be fully focused on the task at hand. Now, while today it would be kind of odd, for example, if some random missionary who you had no knowledge of just came knocking at your door and said, "Oh, can I stay with you tonight?" You know, that would be kind of odd in this day and age. But at that time, it was very commonplace to extend hospitality in the ancient Near East to even strangers who passed through your house. And so Jesus gives protocol for that as well, that when you go out to these people's place, that you would greet them with the words, "Peace be to this house." And he says, well, if your greeting is received, then you'll know that that's someone who recognizes that your gospel ministry, that this person, you know, agrees with the work that you're doing. So that's one thing that he tells them. And then in verse 7, he tells them this, "And remain in the same house, eating and drinking what they provide, for the laborer deserves his wages. Do not go from house to house." And this is one of the principles for serving the Lord in ministry, especially for those who are called to the mission field, that we really have to trust in his provision and depend on the generosity of others. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9:14, "In the same way the Lord commanded that those who proclaim the gospel should get their living by the gospel." So those who are called to the mission field, you know, we have people who've come here, go around to churches to share about their work, to raise support for this mission, and even for me, doing short-term mission trips, you know, I've had to write out support letters to ask for financial assistance, and it really is a humbling experience when you have to depend on others, but ultimately you're depending on the Lord for his provision and support on your trip. And as I said earlier, Bethany has continued to place this priority on missions, and many of you here in the congregation support the work of our missionaries around the world. So when we partner with missionaries, when we support them in this way, we're kind of, in a way, being that hospitality team, that we're helping provide food and housing for them so that they can go out and do the ministry work that they've been called to do. And finally, Jesus sends these 72 disciples out with their mission, with the purpose of their mission, which was to go out to heal and to preach. He says this, "Heal the sick in it and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near to you." Now, John the Baptist, who came to prepare the way for Jesus, he began to preach this message in the wilderness of Judea, saying in Matthew 3, verse 2, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And then when Jesus began his own ministry, we read in Matthew 4, 17, "From that time Jesus began to preach, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." So this is a message that's been continually emphasized as they go out and minister out in Israel. And he gives the authority to the 12 apostles to heal and preach in Luke 9, and now he gives that same authority to the 72 who he is sending out. Now, after Jesus dies and has risen from the dead, and as he's preparing to ascend to heaven, he sends his disciples out once again in Acts 1, verse 8, saying this, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." And that was the birth of the church. And the Lord has continued to raise people up and commission people to be his witnesses until the present time. Even now, he continues to send us out into the world. Now, all Jesus called his disciples to do was simply to be his messengers, simply to share that message. In verses 10 and 11, we read this, "But whenever you enter a town and they do not receive you, go into its streets and say, even the dust of your town that clings to your feet we wipe off against you. Nevertheless, know this, that the kingdom of God has come near. So when we share with other people, there's going to be times where we're rejected, where people, they don't want to hear. But, and I know we have that feeling that we're somehow responsible, maybe. Oh, I really want this person to come to the Lord. Oh, I really want this person to be saved. But you know what? All we can do is share the message and trust that the Lord is going to work on their heart. And if they do not hear the message or reject it, that's between them and the Lord. So all we can do is share and let God do the rest. So what does this mean for all of us? You may be thinking, well, I'm not called to the mission field. God hasn't called me to the mission field. And true, not all of us will be called to become career missionaries. But we can be part of the behind-the-scenes work. And one thing we can do is to pray for those who've been called into Christian ministry. As we pray for our pastors, pray for our elders, pray for other Christian leaders, and pray for our missionaries, those who've been called to serve the Lord in that capacity. We can be a part of that support and hospitality team for our missionaries as we share our financial gifts with them. But even if we have not been called to full-time ministry, all of us, as followers of Jesus Christ, all of us here, we've been given that great commission where Jesus said in Matthew 28, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age." So all of us have been given that mission to share the good news of the gospel with others. The harvest is plentiful. And the harvest doesn't have to be some far-off nation. The harvest is wherever the Lord has placed us, right here in our own backyard, where there is a very high percentage of people who are unchurched. So as the body of Christ here at Bethany, may we seek to be ministers, may we seek to be those disciples who've been sent out for the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we go out, as we go out, as we come into contact with friends, neighbors, family members, that we would be the lambs in the midst of wolves. And we're living in some very interesting times, I think. You know, when we look at the world around us, when we see all of the things that are happening here in this nation, around the world, you know, we really don't know when the Lord may return. It may be very soon. And there are so many out there who are in need of hearing the good news of the gospel, hearing that message. So I hope that there would be an urgency, that the kingdom of God is at hand, and all we're called to do is share God's word. Isaiah 55 says, "So shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish what I purpose, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. The fields are ripe with the harvest. Let's go out and share God's good news." Let us pray. O Lord, you tell us that the harvest is plentiful and the laborers are few. Even here in this place, in Santa Barbara, this city that is so beautiful, this city that where there is so much affluence, yet, Lord, it is a city that there's a sense of emptiness because there are so many who do not know you, Lord. And so help us as the body of Christ here at Bethany Church. May we be the people that you've sent out. May we be lambs amidst wolves, sharing your love and compassion. May we go out and preach that the kingdom of God is at hand. Lord, we don't know when you will return, but Lord, it may be soon, looking at the world around us. So help us to have that urgency to go out and share with whoever is willing to listen, family, friends, neighbors, that they would come, that people, Lord, would come to hear and to receive your word, that we pray that you would draw many to yourself. And so, Lord, just help us to be your hands and feet and to be a people of the Great Commission, that we would go out and make disciples of all nations. Father, we lift all these things up in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand once again as you are able for the closing hymns. Psalm 126 tells us this: He who goes out weeping, bearing the seed of sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. Let's sing this last song.
Of reaping, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, sowing in the sunshine, sowing in the shadows, fearing neither clouds nor winter chilling breeze. By and by the harvest and the labor ended, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall go rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Going forth with weeping, sowing for a pastor, delivered us to stain our spirit often breathes. While the weeping's over, we will bid us welcome. We shall go rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves.
And now for our doxology. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Please join us for a time of fellowship and have a good week.